you can totally have that hat.
Ooh, okay.
A bunch from there. As soon as it expires. So there's a people there.
I'm going to send out, I think the way it works is other people can only watch on the link that I sent instead of participate. Hey, Josiah.
Hey, what's up?
Hey, how are you?
Pretty okay.
So we've got three people here today, including myself.
Cool.
John is over here.
Yeah.
Sarah's over here.
Are you at the hack space or?
So we're at the Tinderbox, which is our hangout spot.
Tinderbox?
We recently got some lab space that was leased, and we're going to move in December 1st.
Hold on, I'm getting some feedback. All right. Oh, where's the space at?
It's in North Austin.
Cool. Yeah, so I usually come out to Austin every March for South by Southwest.
Okay.
But totally would love, I'm pretty sure I'm coming out this year. I would totally love to check it out. So I'll hit you guys up.
Great.
And you give me a tour of everything.
You're definitely welcome. It'd be cool to have you over here. We've been in touch with Karen Ingram.
Oh, really?
And hope to be a part of next year's South by.
Oh, super cool. Awesome. Yeah, Karen and I are good friends.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Sweet. So I think I'm going to email the new link one more time because I think the first one I sent was...
I think it's working.
It is? Okay.
That's what I was getting feedback from because I was like watching it and on this hangout with you guys.
Okay.
So I'm pretty sure it's working. Unless you're getting messages from people that
No, I haven't.
I mean, initially everybody was like, "Why isn't it working?"
Okay. I'm going to send out one more email anyway.
All right, do it. Yeah, it looks like there's we got like 10 viewers or so. I don't know how they message us. I guess we just watch as the page updates. Why don't you all introduce yourself? Maybe who's in the background?
So Josiah, Sean. Can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, cool.
Hi, Josiah. My name's Sarah.
What's up, Sarah? What's up, Sean?
What's going on?
Are y'all just like DIY biohackers? Do you have any experience?
I don't know. Very, very little experience with genetic stuff. No, mostly just food and regular living, trying to apply that hacker ethic to the day to day. But yeah, I got to see you at South by last year.
Oh, you did? No way.
2014. Yeah.
2014 last year. Was that the one where I gave that awesome 15-minute presentation and I was like drunk?
Oh man. I don't know. That sounds fun. I think we were just at like a panel at the Long Center.
Oh, okay. So it wasn't so it was 2014, not this last year.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. This last year was pretty awesome.
Yeah.
I gave like a 15-minute talk. And they give you, like, free drinks if you're a speaker.
Mm-hmm.
But I just, like, stocked up before I went on stage. It was pretty fun.
Nice. Yeah, I don't have too much experience, but I was checking out your Indiegogo campaign and definitely got really interested about it. Started doing some research. Decided to talk to you more about it, see what you had cooking up, and
Cool. You guys also let me know when you get your space set up, because I totally want to help you guys out. I'll send you.
All right. Thank you. That would be wonderful.
To get some stuff going. Yeah.
Some plasmids, some kits or something.
Yeah. Strains, plasmids, you know. I love to see people doing science. That's like my number one goal, right? So ask anybody who's bought anything from like the ODIN or anything like that, like, oh my gosh, I help people troubleshoot everything, email like everybody, you know. It's just, that's my number one goal, is to see people doing science, right? Because it's like I say in that Indiegogo video, it's like, what happens if the scientific population of the world doubled, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, just because I do science, it doesn't mean I'm smart. Like, anybody can do it. It doesn't take a smart person, a person who's like a genius or anything, right?
Yeah, I think the reason biotech development has been so slow is probably just because there are so few people doing it. If we had a lot more humans going that were all sort of everywhere, then I could definitely see, like, when the information age happened and everybody started having computers, knowledge that was once known by very few started becoming very common. Like, so many people I know are coders. And they just get that language. I think
yeah.
that molecular biology could easily be the same way.
Yeah, no, I totally agree, right?
Yeah.
It's like, I almost failed out of high school, you know, went to community college for a few years, you know, then went to school, did my PhD and everything like that, wound up at NASA. But it's like, I'm nothing special. I'm not like God's gift to geniuses or anything like that. And if I could do it, it means anybody can do it. And that's what I think is the most important thing. It's like, you can't think, oh man, you know, scientists have told people for so long and everybody like, oh, it's, you know, it's too hard. These things are too complicated. We don't want you reading like science papers. That's why we make them cost money, right? Because they're for smart people and all this other stuff. And it's totally not true. It's just the worst thing that you could possibly imagine, right? And it's so sad because, like, somebody out there could be the genius who finds something that, you know, dissolves all the plastic in the environment, or, like, creates a renewable fuel that's so inexpensive, right? In their home, that could happen. But it will never happen if we don't give people access to the tools, right? So that's what is just crazy to me. Why would you want to stop that from happening? I don't know. What would you create? I like to ask that question. What would you create?
It's a beautiful question. Can you...
No, I'm asking you. What would you create?
There's a lot of things I would create. I'll give you an answer in time.
Yeah, I know, right? Maybe like give us like 25 minutes or
yeah,
a little further conversation. I was just having this conversation earlier today, and like the list is like long and improbable, but I realized I actually have no idea what possible looks like right now.
Well, that's okay though, right? Because people often ask me that, like, well, you know, what's possible? What can people really do? And I say, well, that's an awful question to ask, right? Because if you ask the people in the 1960s, well, what could a computer do? They would never have said, like, well, one day it'll be this handheld device that people will use for everything. And, you know, even like, you know, as a microscope, and, you know, it has enough computational power to do all these things. Like, nobody would have ever imagined that. So I think to have improbable ideas is good right now, because it's still in that growing phase, right? And in 10 years, who knows what's possible or probable as compared to now, right? Right now, it might not be possible or probable, and it's good to know that. But, like, who knows in the future?
What's your long-term goal or vision? Like, what problems are you working on or do you think are the most important?
So one problem I'm working on right now is the whole plastic degradation thing. I worked on it a bit at NASA because astronauts use about, I think it's like 300 pounds of plastic per person per year. Because like all food is packaged in plastic, right? Because plastic is so good. It's just so inert. So they just vacuum seal everything in plastic, send up the International Space Station, and like it's used. So I was working on that because if you go to Mars and you send like a 4-person crew, it takes a year to get there. When you arrive, you know, you have a ridiculous amount of plastic, you know, over 1,000 pounds. What can you do with it? You can throw it out, or you can figure out how to recycle it or compost it or turn it into fuel or sugars or something like that. And now if you think about the Earth, there's about 32 billion, I think my numbers are correct. In the U.S., there's about 32 billion kilograms of plastic waste each year. That's insane. And like about 10% is recycled. So you're just talking about 28, 29 billion kilograms of plastic waste. Like, how much longer can we keep that up? I don't know, but that's a fucking lot. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know how it is in Texas, but like they don't even allow you to recycle plastic bags in California anymore. Just because nobody will recycle them because of the cost. It costs so much more to recycle a plastic bag than it does to just make them that nobody's willing to do it. It just all go to waste. So they're like outlawing plastic bags and stuff. But it's like, you gotta be other options. What if we could engineer microbes that they could just spread around on, you know, the waste at trash dumps that break down the plastics much faster than they would normally be broken down?
So how would we control, like if we had some bacteria that digested plastic much faster, how would we keep those out of through hospitals, for example? Like, wouldn't they want to spread anywhere that plastic was?
Oh, sure. Well, I mean, you have to understand that though, like, say we make plastic degrade, you know, 100% in 2 years or something like that as compared to, you know, 30 years. Like, not much is going to be harmed by plastic that takes 2 years to degrade plastic, right? Has to be in around that bacteria for 2 years, constantly being, you know, enzymes being secreted on it, being degraded, right?
Okay.
You have it in like a hospital or a building, the bacteria are going to wash away with rain, with water, the UV light is going to kill them. Like, it would be hard to get it on, like, to crumble a structure made of plastic just because you'd need the constant culture. Whereas I've worked with a couple people up in Yolo County, California, Yolo, and they have these huge bioreactors. They're just insane. It's basically just like this giant mass of ground that they cover up with tarps, like massive tarps. And it's just this bioreactor. And they collect the methane gas from it. So they have these environments already in place where you could just deposit the plastic. They have these giant reactors, you know, where the bacteria are already in there in the ground or that you can seed. It's perfect for the plastic degradation, mm-hmm. You know?
I mean, I love the idea. In this moment, something I'm wondering about is there a way to control the rate of evolution of these bacteria? Like if we got some bacteria that through directed evolutionary means we were able to make them really good at digesting plastic at a certain rate, wouldn't they, if we just threw them on a lot of plastic, wouldn't they learn how to digest it even faster if they used it as part of their metabolic process, if they were using it for energy, for example?
Maybe. It depends. So you're talking about, will they just get really good at it, or will they get really good at it and we want them to get good at it?
I'm wondering if it's possible that they could get better at it than we had planned, I guess. Although we made them good at it, they would get better and better at it if it was part of their process for generating energy. And then it'd be really good.
So, yeah, it's possible if you select for it. So you have to understand that I've done this calculation before. So a bacterial genome is about 3 million bases. The number one way it gets mutated is probably UV light. So you need UV light exposure. Let's say we allowed the bacteria to get exposed to UV light. Usually in a bioreactor, they're covered up in some way. But let's just assume they're exposed to UV light. So the probability of any single base being mutated is to a specific base is 4 to the 3 million? No. Yes. 4 to the 3 million. And that is, or 3 to 3 million, because you already have it at a specific base. So there's three other bases it can mutate to. And the probability that it gets that base to a certain base in the whole genome is just astronomical.
Uh-huh.
Evolution is such a complicated and difficult process. That's why it requires like billions of years. The interesting thing though is one of the ways I've searched for bacteria that can degrade plastic is by going out to trash dumps and collecting waste and washing off the bacteria, because plastic has been around for a long time, surprisingly.
How long has it been around? Like 100?
I think like 100 years.
100 years?
Yeah.
In bacteria years, that's a long time.
Yeah, right, totally, right? Because bacteria divides like every 20 minutes, well, a certain bacteria. So let's just say on average every 20 minutes, right? So that's a lot of bacteria years. In some of them, I found a bunch of bacteria that have like minute plastic degradation abilities.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it really requires, on a time scale that we would want to happen, it really requires you. It requires a genetic engineer.
Okay.
It requires somebody who's at least selecting part of the genome and saying, only mutate this part of the genome. You know, only mutate the metabolic part. Don't mutate, you know, the things that are involved in DNA replication and stuff like that.
I can understand, and that's really cool.
Yeah.
So how do you go about trying to isolate the genes or DNA sequences responsible for that plastic degradation and those bacteria you found?
So there's two different ways. One way is like a transcriptome analysis. So what you do is you'll grow the bacteria, say, with plastic as their sole carbon source, and then you'll grow them in a media that they use, like, you know, glucose or something as their carbon source. And you'll look at what genes are expressed. So you'll look at the mRNA, and you'll sequence all that, and you'll look at the different genes that are expressed in the two different conditions, right? So you'd expect that genes that are expressed that are used to degrade plastic, you know, when they're under carbon stress, when they need to express those genes to degrade plastic, they'll express them more in the plastic condition as opposed to the glucose or whatever condition. The other one is you can actually, so they, some of them secrete proteins, and you can just isolate the proteins by either washing off the plastic or taking the media that the bacteria are in and identifying the proteins that are in the media and seeing if those, right? Because a lot of it's going to be an enzyme, so you can kind of narrow it down, right? If you get a weird gene that comes up in your transcriptome analysis or in your protein analysis, you know, a DNA binding protein or something, you can be like, eh, that probably doesn't really have much to do with it. It's probably going to be an enzyme. It's probably going to be something that breaks a carbon bond, right? Because plastic is just these long carbon chains. So you can kind of break it down using, you know, just logic and some simple experiments.
So I'm just curious, if we find a gene that is of interest in our plastic eating bacteria reactor, and we find the enzyme, how do we know that the enzyme breaks a carbon bond? Is it that we look up a database of this gene is associated with this enzyme was associated with this carbon bond, or is it something that we can logic out or experiment?
Yeah, so you can. So there are a lot of databases of that stuff, right? A lot of proteins that do a lot of similar things look a lot alike. It's just how evolution works, right?
Yeah.
You had the initial protein that evolved, you know, billions of years ago or whatever, that was able to break a carbon bond or something similar to it. And then a bunch of other proteins evolved from that might have broken specific different types of carbon bonds or something like that. So they have this like hereditary evolutionary lineage, which people tend to call homology. And you can trace it back like that sometimes. It's kind of difficult just from the, you know, structure and the different amino acids and stuff. But you can do experiments. I've done a couple of spectroscopic experiments, Fourier transform, infrared spectroscopy, other things to look at the change in the chemical nature of the plastic to see if, like, you know, the carbon bonds are different in some way.
Okay.
If there's oxygen that's added or something like that. Yeah, you can do it for sure.
So you're how long have you been working at NASA Ames?
About 2 years.
2 years. And you're finishing up in January?
Yeah, I'm going to take off in January.
What are you doing then? Are you doing the ODIN full time, or are you doing personal stuff or another company? Or
no, I'm going to be working on the ODIN and working on hopefully projects like the plastic degradation. Teaching. I'm around a lot of the biohacker spaces in the Bay Area.
Yeah.
I help out with projects out here.
Biocurious or where?
Biocurious and Counterculture Labs, both of them. I want to start getting into so most of the stuff I've been doing at home right now is like, you know, been developing products for people, testing out experiments to get stuff working at home. But just today when I was setting up a PCR reaction, I was testing out some more stuff and I was like, shit, you know, I really need to start getting my own projects at home and not just like do business stuff. It'd be super cool because that's when you're like staying up at night, right? When you're like staying up late at night in your kitchen, you're like, oh, man, I want to see this gel. You know, I want to see what happens.
So let's see. Can you walk us through at first what it's like to be a synthetic biologist at NASA? What experiments were you doing? What were you working on in the past 2 years out there?
So it's pretty crazy because it's NASA, right? So when you first arrive, they have like these giant hangars and like old rockets laying around and like all that stuff. Pretty impressive. And everybody grows up, well, not everybody. Most people grow up as a kid like wanting to be an astronaut or wanting to be involved with NASA. Mm-hmm. So it's super cool. Super awesome. I found out eventually that there's not a lot of money at NASA, unfortunately.
The budget just gets cut every year.
Yeah. Yeah. And that there's not a lot of employees because of that. So for my first year, it was just me in this probably like 2,000 square foot lab and just working by myself, setting up all the equipment, all these things. I had 2 summer interns that year who were pretty cool. But, you know, that was it. My second year, some other people joined, but they were working on different projects. So it got a bit depressing because you're like working on this project and you're like, damn, you know. So if you want to get something up on the International Space Station, say, you write a grant. And the grants that come out, the solicitations, are about every year and a half, every 2 years for projects to send up to the International Space Station. If you get the grant, right, then you don't get the money for another year or two. once you get the money, then you're probably not going up on a rocket for another year or two. And then to get your experiment back, right, it has to come down from the International Space Station. They have to collect it. They have to get it back to you. That's like another 6 months to a year or whatever. So you're talking like 5-6 years between the time you write a grant to get something up in the International Space Station. So the science up there is like so far behind anything. And then if you saw, like, this year, I think it was a Blue Origin rocket blew up. All those experiments are just gone, right?
Yeah, that was a SpaceX rocket, I think.
Well, whatever. All the experiments are gone. And those people are just screwed, so their experiments aren't going to happen. It's not like there's just tons of extra space to send stuff up again.
You don't have any iteration time in order to improve or investigate anything. You need that quick back and forth.
Yeah. So it's just like, and the equipment that's on the ISS is really, really old.
How old is it?
They only allow you to use certain equipment also, which is understandable, right? Because it has to be like seriously tested.
Uh-huh.
Because you can't just send anything up. You can't send up like an Arduino with like some LEDs plugged in and shit, because if like the LED gets lost, you know, it could short circuit something and the whole space station could crash to Earth.
Oh, man.
So everything has to be like rigorously tested in like all these different environments. So it's just like, private space companies are going to be the future of space exploration. I'll tell you that right now. It's just the majority of the NASA workforce right now is over 55. I think like 65% of the employees at NASA are 55 and older. Not that there's anything wrong with people who are 55 and older, like, but I feel like you need fresh input, right? You can't just have a homogenous population of white men who are like doing experiments, or they're not even doing experiments. They're trying to hire people to do experiments. You need younger people. You need people, you know, diversity. But you can't really have diversity because it's hard to get, you know, a government job and everything if you're not a U.S. citizen.
Yeah.
Are the private space companies putting any money forward for gene editing or genetic engineering and that stuff?
Yeah, like
not yet.
Industries has one guy that they got from NASA. What was his name? He goes by Joseph as well as Michael, and he's doing metal eating bacteria for pre-processing asteroids. They're an asteroid mining company.
Oh. Yeah, no, I haven't heard of him, but are you talking about using bacteria to like break down the metals in asteroids?
Yeah.
Yeah, there was some people that, you want to know what happened? There was people at NASA who were working on a project like that,
uh-huh.
And they just canned it because it was such a bad idea. Because it's like, asteroids are in outer space. Like, how are bacteria going to survive out there, number one? Number two, like, how are bacteria or some organism going to process metals better than, like, chemical? Like,
yeah, you by melting, and then you can do density
stuff. Yeah. So that was a synthetic biology project, or it was supposed to be, by some people in Lynn Rothschild's group. A lot of people have heard of her. She tends to be the spokesperson at NASA for synthetic biology, even though she's not in the synthetic biology program at NASA at all. Yeah, and she tried to get this project funded, and they were just like, no.
Okay. Was there, I know SpaceX's stated mission is terraforming and colonizing Mars.
Yeah, I think they'll do it. You want to know why? It's because NASA's good at what they do. What they're good at is making things succeed, right? The International Space Station has been a major success. Amazing that we have, you know, it's like the size of a football, you know, American football field.
Yeah.
It's huge, and it's floating around Earth, and there's like 4 to 8 people living on it at any given time. That is the coolest thing when you imagine that. So amazing, right? but they're not willing to push any boundaries. And that's where they fall, because everything they do, they want to succeed on first try, because they kind of, you know, the government can't have a situation where they waste billions of dollars or people die, right? That's no government official wants that.
The glory of the state.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. Whereas, like, SpaceX or somebody like that, right? There have already been private astronauts that have died, right? So it's like...
Okay.
Companies are willing to... People and companies are willing to accept the risks that NASA can't accept. And so NASA's just going to be beat.
Is that a... I like to think that's the way that biotech will work out as well.
No, totally. I agree about that, right? I posted something on my Facebook today that was similar to that. I recently wrote an art grant, an art science. I do some art science work.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. And I wrote a grant about a future where we're tracked by our microbiomes and our DNA and all these things. And the idea was to do some, like, DIY, like, mammalian cell engineering.
Okay.
And also, like, a full-body microbiome transplant. So, like, could I clone somebody else's microbiome on me? Could I, like, take antibiotics, go to a hotel room, take somebody's microbiome, and, like, cover myself with it, and, like, transplant them to me? And, like, how would it affect me? Obviously, you know, people tell me, oh, there's, like, health risks and all this stuff associated with it. But, like, what happens if there's somebody who, like, I don't know, like, I'm lactose intolerant, and I also have some, like, you know, get indigestion and stuff sometimes. What happens if it, like, cures that shit? I don't know. What happens if it makes me super smart? What happens if I steal somebody's microbiome who's, like, really smart, and then I become really smart? Wouldn't that be awesome?
90% of the serotonin in your body is produced in the gut by your microbiome.
There we go, right? So, like, but nobody's willing to explore these things because they're like, oh, safety and health. Yeah, there are chances that you can, like, you know, get some, but most things are treatable, right?
Mm-hmm.
Most of the diseases or risks are, like, small, but, like, obviously if you work at a university, they have, like, the human research things that people have to sign. You, like, can't do any of these experiments at a university. But that was a proposal. It didn't get funded. I still want to do it, but it's like, I think biotech people will be able to push the limits like this, explore these different possibilities of, like, what can we create? What can we do? Things like that.
So can you tell us about the evolution of your kits, of how you've designed them, and sort of what, if there's any pattern, or can you reflect on this, like, what was your first kit, what drove you to do it, and now we're at the CRISPR kit, too, so I really want to hear how that works.
Okay, hold on one sec. Somebody sent me some questions.
All right.
CRISPR allows us to do copy and paste operations on DNA segments, but what would be the possible ways to write a software-generated sequence into DNA, specifically from the product? So that's a super cool thing. So the plasmids that are going to be provided with the CRISPR kit, it's pretty simple. You're just going to have to take some restriction enzymes, which, I mean, you'll either be able to order on the ODIN, my company website, or I'll include them with the kit or something. We'll see. It depends how much interest there is in this. And you just cut out a piece of DNA that has, right, so there's specific elements in the CRISPR system that make it work. There's the guide RNA, which is complementary to the DNA gene that you're trying to edit. And then there's a template DNA, which is actually the thing that mutates the gene. So it's what, CRISPR doesn't actually mutate DNA. That's the crazy thing. What it does is it tricks the cell into using your DNA to fix its own DNA. So what CRISPR does is it cuts the DNA, and the cell says, oh, my DNA is messed up. Now I need to fix it. Do I have a template to fix this DNA? and then looks around, and your template DNA is right there, and it's like, oh, I found a template DNA to fix this, and then it uses your template DNA to fix it, except you have the mutation in there, and that's how it mutates the DNA. So it's a really funny, tricky thing. But yeah, there are websites right now, I'll provide them in, you know, the protocols and stuff like that, where you can just go and order, anybody can order DNA. One of them is IDT, IDTDNA.com. I order DNA from there all the time. We would just be able to order the DNA, stick it in the plasmid, and you'll be able to edit the genes that you want to edit, not just the example experiments that are included in the kit. Yeah. So why CRISPR and stuff like that? I think my main goal, as I talked about initially in the beginning, is just to show people how accessible things are. And everybody hears about CRISPR in the news and all these things, and they think it's this magical thing that exists off in the world of science, whatever science may be, and that scientists do this thing with it. What I'm trying to show them is that, no, it's something that's accessible to you, that you can do experiments with it. You can actually use the same cutting-edge tools that scientists can if people just made it accessible, right? If somebody was just there saying, all right, there's this new cutting-edge tool, I'm going to have a resource so somebody could come and get this cutting-edge tool from me, right? Because if you go and you ask some of the professors or something, hey, I see you develop this thing, you know, can you help me out, or, you know, maybe can you send me some DNA or something like that? They're going to blow you off, because to them they think, oh, what is this kid in his garage going to do? What is this guy in his garage going to do? But they don't know that a guy in his garage, you know, invented Linux. Maybe they do. They just choose to ignore it, right? Linux is probably, what, 90% of the server operating systems in the world? Invented by some guy in Helsinki, Finland, who was a master's student, working in his, like, probably mom's basement, right? They don't understand that that's the possibility, that that's the future. No, I don't. These cutting-edge tools are not cost-prohibitive in the context of tinkering. Go to the ODIN website, right? Mm-hmm. The thing is companies mark up everything 1,000-fold. Somebody posted on some news article that was about the CRISPR kit, and they're like, there's no way he can sell these kits for $150. Pipettes alone cost $400. No, they don't. The companies just mark them up 100-fold, and they sell them to you to $400 because academic labs are willing to pay that much.
Right.
But I can go order the same exact pipettes from the same manufacturer, and I can charge you, you know, $50 for them.
Yeah,
I'm not marking it up 100-fold.
If the academic labs are willing to pay that much, that tells me that they're inundated with corruption, because they're not seriously looking for a reasonable price.
Well, it's not that they're inundated in corruption. They're just like, they don't know any better. And they don't really care. It's not their money. If you had a $250,000 a year grant, would you say, all right, I'm going to spend an hour trying to find, you know, the best price for this, for every single thing you order, or you're just going to say, fuck it, I'm going to go to one of the big websites like Sigma or Fisher and just order whatever they have. Getting $250,000, $500,000 a year, maybe more, you don't give a shit. You're just like, I'm going to go to Fisher.
Mm-hmm.
And that's wrong, right? And Fisher's never going to bring down their prices because people are always going to pay them. So it allows the ODIN to be this kind of niche, you know, store where it's like, look, you don't have to charge these prices. You can get the same exact stuff, same exact quality.
So does the ODIN take Bitcoin yet?
If you want to purchase something in Bitcoin, I totally will take it. You just have to send me an email. On the website it doesn't. It's not set up that way. I actually haven't thought about that. I just sold off a bunch of my Bitcoin, though, when it recently went up, which was nice.
Sweet.
But, I have a Bitcoin account and everything. If you want to, you know, send Bitcoin, I'd totally be willing to take that. $150 is cost prohibitive to many people, though. Yeah. You know what, though? A cell phone costs more than $150. A laptop costs way more, you know. If you want to invest in a hobby, $150 is relatively cheap to get, you know, a starting kit for it. You know, I play soccer shoes, just a pair of shoes. I can't even get a ball. It cost me $150. So I know it seems kind of expensive, but I also got to make a little bit of money.
He's saying you would need to spend that $150 over and over again in order to do meaningful research.
No, you don't. So right. So if you have a pipette, right? If you have all the major equipment, which I'm working on manufacturing and providing, getting the cost on those down really low. I recently built like a gel electrophoresis power supply, which usually go for $100-$150. Can make it for like $10 or $20.
Whoa.
That'll be on the website soon. The ODIN website.
Once you invest in
the basic equipment, right? Mm-hmm. All the basic equipment, hopefully, you know, it'll be like $500. Right, reagents are super, super inexpensive. You get the media to grow the bacteria, right? And then your only prices are whenever you order new DNA. Right?
Mm-hmm.
That's it. And, you know, some guy emailed me the other day. He ordered some bacteria from me. He was trying to get it to grow. Couldn't get it to grow. He was trying some, you know, DIY media, which was super clever. But I was like, hey, man, I'll just send you the media, right? It's like $5, $10. Like, no sweat off my back, right? You don't have the money. I understand. Like, it's not cost prohibitive in any reasonable way as compared to almost every other hobby.
Yeah, this guy Drew showed me an electrophoresis little box that was $300, and I looked at it, and I know how to laser cut and 3D print things, and it looked like something that could easily be laser cut for less than $5.
Yeah, right? No, totally. And the platinum wires, they're the most expensive thing, and you can buy them on eBay for like $5.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's like, and companies will sell it to people for $200, mm-hmm. $250, right? That's because that's what people are willing to pay. And it's like, we just need somebody to try to manufacture these things and sell them to people for like $30-$40 that make, you know, a decent profit, but they're also, you know, not, you know, causing people to spend a ton of money.
Yeah, when the demand is distributed, the price is driven down.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't think that'll happen for a long time because I think this people are always going to be willing to pay the $200, $250, at least for a while, because you have companies, you have academic labs, all these things. So I think it's going to be an interesting market to see who pops up. I think it's going to be akin to like the hobbyist electronics market. I don't know if you guys ever go on like Adafruit or Spark Fun or any of those places.
Yeah.
I think it'll be kind of like that, like more for hobbyists. Like you can go to like places like DigiKey or other places and buy the exact part you need for less expensive if you know the exact part you need, you know. But SparkFun provides tutorials. They provide it all in a nice place. They provide it for, you know, good price. So it's like,
mm-hmm.
Okay.
Community labs also would offset some of these costs. I mean, besides just manufacturing or finding ways to make the item, I mean, if you have it collectively owned and always in use, then you really get a lot more bang for your buck with that initial cost.
Yeah, community labs is also true. Like, community labs usually have, you know, the materials. So, like, you spend, you know, I don't know how much you guys will end up charging. I know some of the hackerspaces out here are a little bit expensive. They're like $100 a month. But, like, you get access to every piece of equipment you'd ever need. So instead of having to drop, you know, $1,000, $1,500, $2,000, you know, for a year you pay $1,200 and you get access to, you know, pipette tips, all the consumables you need, all the equipment you need. You just have to buy, you know, the media and the reagents and stuff, which aren't too expensive.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to be right back.
Okay. Let's take a break.
So how's everything going with, like, getting funding for the kits and mm-hmm. all the other?
What's up?
How's it going getting funding for the kits?
Oh, it's pretty cool, you know? Way surpassed my goals. I'm just, the biggest thing is I'm just trying to make it all, like, accessible to people. My biggest goal was just to get as many people as possible to purchase the kits so I get it in the hands of as many people as I can.
Yeah.
You know, if I could provide it for free, I would, but unfortunately, I also got to pay the bills. I have a cat. It doesn't want to live outside with me. So I have to charge some money for it. But, yeah, just getting those kits into the hands of people. Oh, why don't I show you guys around my little lab? How about that? Would that be fun?
That's exciting.
Been running some experiments tonight, so we'll see.
Josiah's lab.
All right.
Let me turn on the lights. Let's see if we can. Trying to figure out how to point to the laptop screen. Can you guys see?
Yes, we can.
So here's my kitchen table. It's got a, you know, centrifuge. It's got my fluorescence, DNA, viewing light. My PCR machine, reagents, fun stuff, Chuck Norris autobiography when I need to get inspired. there's the rest of my kitchen. You can see experiments next to the toaster. About to run a gel with some PCRs I just ran. I clean and wash all my tubes and stuff to reuse them, save money.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is basically, this is what your apartment could look like.
Awesome. So, like, there's a lot of, like, plastic and glass pieces in there, but it all looks, like, fairly simple. If you were to cost out your kitchen setup, what would that run you right now?
What would it run? So on the Indiegogo, it's selling for like $3,000, but that's like, that's if you wanted everything you needed to do molecular biology and genetic engineering and a ton of different experiments. If you were going to go minimalist and just buy all the materials, I say you could probably get all the stuff for $1,000 or less.
Nice.
For sure.
So all the stuff, meaning like those Falcon tubes and all the holders and the pipette and the PCR machine and the fluorescent little thing, is what and the reagents, and then is that it?
Yeah. So, obviously, like, getting things like restriction enzymes and other things, that's going to cost you more money. Getting, you know, flasks if you want to grow up, you know, larger cultures of bacteria. Getting, you know, larger media bottles and things like that, that's going to cost you more. But, okay, like, basically all you need, plastic tubes, pipettes, PCR machines, centrifuge, gel electrophoresis. And you're good to go. All that together with some media, you could probably do. I mean, if you guys, you know, are in need of equipment, contact me. I'll help you guys find stuff. you could probably do it for less than $1,000 just for like a minimal setup that's totally functional.
All right.
And I'm always trying to, like, today I just found this company that sells this, you know, polymerase for PCR, so much less expensive than I've been getting it. And I just tested it out yesterday, tested it out today. Works great, and it's like 10 times less in price what I normally charge.
Wow.
Okay. Right?
So I'm always looking for things to bring that price down. I'm always looking to bring it down. So, like, hopefully on the website, the price on that's going to go down. So, like, I'm always working to, you know, get those prices down, test out comparable products that are less expensive, that people have better access.
Can you walk us through the CRISPR process, for example? Like, what is a restriction enzyme? What exactly does that do?
So it's the CRISPR process. So like I talked about before, so what people are basically going to do is, it's great. So I've been working on videos and stuff, and hopefully early next year they'll all be up. Also, like, written protocols I've been working on. It will take people, depending on where you are in your knowledge, from, like, the basics of, like, what's DNA, what does DNA do, how to use a pipette, right, if you've never used a micropipette before, all the way to, like, how does CRISPR work and how are we going to get CRISPR work into the system in your organism of choice, so whether it's bacteria, yeast, or something like that. Basically, your whole goal in any genetic engineering experiment is to get your DNA into the host cell DNA. And that's going to be the goal of people who are doing the experiment. There are different chemical methods, different things you can do. So that's going to all be, you know, in a protocol. I'm sure I could go through it step by step, but it would probably be kind of pointless. I can send you guys some stuff I have written up if you're more interested in further details. But yeah, it's basically learn how to do every step, culture, you know, organisms, use all the tools, and then learn how to genetic engineer. And then once you learn that, it'll give you, you know, examples of future experiments you could do. So hopefully people can progress with their knowledge beyond just the example experiments that comes with the kit, and they could do their own experiments for their own things. Yeah.
Okay. Drew wants to know how many reactions you can get out of one kit.
Oh, so it's going to be a lot. It'll probably be somewhere like 10. It really depends on, like, how much resources you use for culturing and all these other things, but, you know, how many plates you use for the different stuff. So, you know, some, like, 20 plates, enough media to grow up, you know, or to make 20 plates to grow up the bacteria and the yeast and stuff like that. So it all depends on how many you use, but I would say anywhere from 5 to 20, depending on how wasteful or how non-wasteful you are with your resources. Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds like a good amount.
Yeah, right? Because it's really not... It's the initial setup cost, what I'm trying to say, is like most of the stuff, right? If you don't have a pipette, these experiments are really hard to do. If you don't have the plasticware, it's really hard to do, right? Once you get these things, the cost of the media then is not too expensive. It still can be, you know, somewhat expensive, but it's not too expensive. So it's just getting, you know, it's getting a pipette in every household. That's what I want to do, right? Have a pipette in every household. So then if people want to do experiments, they can always just do it, right? The problem is nobody has a pipette, so it's not like... You have the basics. Can you bargain for essentials? Of course you can bargain for essentials. Just email me. Like, I am always willing to bargain or help people out. That's what's the great thing about running your own business also is you can be as nice or as mean as you want to people. So it's really great to just see people succeed at experiments and flourish and stuff like that. So it's super nice just to be like, you know, you call up a customer service rep and you're like, oh man, I really need this thing and I only have like $10 till payday, there's going to be like, screw you. But I can be like, all right, sounds like a good deal. Let's do it.
I'm going to stay out of frame, but this is Mike. Drew's out of frame too. But you were saying earlier that you can't, or not everybody has a pipette or whatever. What do you think about clouds of biolabs? Like if you centralized it, you or NASA had a central repeated cell lab, and then people logged in and said, put in these inputs or these, I want to run this experiment in some kind of parameterized form, and then everyone's goal with logging into this cloud of biolabs is to get the new output that you guys might have thought about.
No, there are companies that are doing that, cloud labs. The problem is that right now the cost of DNA synthesis is still high enough, which should not say it's high, right? You can order your DNA sequences for like, I don't know, 10 cents a base pair or something like that.
Yeah.
But it's high enough that you don't want to synthesize DNA every time you're doing an experiment, so you have to send your experiment basically to these labs.
Yeah, but the problem with these labs is they have humans and that costs a lot of money. So if there was some way that you can automate the material injection, just like...
No. Some of them have robots. So look up Emerald Cloud Labs, Emerald Therapeutics, Emerald Cloud Labs, also Transcriptics. They use robots and stuff. They still charge a lot. But also, it's like your turnaround time, right? Like, in my kitchen, right? Today, before I ate lunch, I was just like, I'm going to set up this PCR reaction. So I set it up, put the stuff in. I actually was testing out a kit at the same time, so I was using my own cheek cells, you know? Using my own cheek cells, purifying the DNA from it, then doing PCR reaction, test out the new polymerase and kit and stuff like that. I could just do that. If you want to do that in a cloud lab, right, you'd have to purify your cheek cells, send it to the lab. That would take, you know, if you paid for the overnight, it would take, you know, 24 hours. If you didn't, it would take 3 days. Once it arrived, then it would probably take a few hours, maybe another day for them to set it up. Then you'd have access to it. So all in all, it's just like, it's not really convenient.
I mean, even if it was in the same city where you could drop it off, you're saying it's both the material... Both the people and the materials, both prohibitive, and you gotta.
I'm sure I could drop it off, but like right, like I said, right. If I want to do an experiment right now or on Saturday,
it's like cooking. Cooking yourself is always faster than putting, even delivering a pizza to you.
Yeah, totally. So if you're lazy and you're willing to pay the extra money, you can order the pizza, but. No, I don't have any problems getting stuff from NEB or IDT, and you shouldn't either. Some companies like Sigma and other chemical companies, chemicals are usually the hard thing to get, even if it's just like sodium chloride. That's one of the reasons I kind of started the ODIN. I was trying to order just like some sodium chloride from Sigma, and they're like, you know, which is just salt, table salt, like thing. And they're like, we won't send it to you because it's an inhalation hazard. And you're like, what? Like, I'm going to, like, inhale salt and kill myself?
A lot of chemicals and mining is distillation, you know? So if you could have your own glassworks or print your own distillery, you could purify it from mining samples or whatever. That's what a lot of these pharmaceutical-grade people are doing. They just have a giant distillery to do this.
Yeah, I mean, 90% of the energy in producing chemicals is spent in purification.
Yikes.
Yeah, I'm not going to do it.
And the other Bader line question I had was chromachord. That sounds super interesting, and it's only associated with you, right?
Yeah, do you want to tell us about chromachord? Is that...
Chromachord. Yeah, so that's what I was talking about with the art and science stuff. So,
like maybe background, like, did you say I want to combine art and bio, or did you say, oh wow, there's new instruments? I wonder if I can do an instrument using biology, like proteins and spectrometry.
So, despite what it may seem, I'm a very introverted type of person. That's why I'm like drinking a beer. It makes me a little bit more outgoing.
Well, that's good.
I like to sit there and just think.
Mm-hmm.
And think and think and come up with crazy ideas. If you find my blog, I have a whole like document that's dedicated just to some of my crazy ideas that you can look at. Feel free to steal any of them if you want.
Even open source, we should attribute credit to you.
No, I don't care. You know, if it's like if what I always say, if you only have one good idea in your life, right? If you're afraid of people stealing your ideas, it's probably because you only have one good idea. Hopefully I have more than one good idea, so feel free to steal away. I'm never going to be able to accomplish them all.
Yeah.
Yeah, ideas are just looking for the right human to grab onto.
So but I was like, sitting there one day.
You went to Germany and you performed with this device, right?
Yeah, so I was sitting there one day and I was thinking and I was like, how can I interface like proteins with electronics, right? Because you can imagine a future where, you know, biological systems start to become more part of our everyday lives.
Yeah. Right?
Maybe where some electronic component or, you know, like we add gasoline to our cars. So it's not unreasonable to think that maybe in the future you'll add glucose to your car or something like that, right? And it'll run on, you know, I don't know, algae energy, whatever. I just made, just saying. So I was like, how can I figure out a way to bring that kind of futuristic thing to the present? How can I make proteins part of an electronic system? I was working with lots of light.
You were just proteins? Because if I were to riff on your thing, couldn't you, because electrical impulses and neurotransmitters are pretty instantaneous, the way your body generates them. So you could actually, without having direct mind control, you can have something that could sense either a neurotransmitter like fright or, you know, squeezing a muscle and make it play a different note directly like that, but without extracting from your body and putting in a spectrometer, right?
Sure, people have done stuff like that, but that's kind of abstract, right? That's on an abstract level. Why not just press the key then? If I had to flex my muscle, why don't I just press the key, right? What's the difference between me flexing my muscle and pressing the key? I guess it's using a different kind of input somewhat. But to me, I wanted a more concrete interaction between actual protein and actual electronics.
So pressing the button and the protein is another, instead of having a mechanical button, you're having this protein do it for you.
So you're actually interacting with the protein through a button, but the protein, the response of the protein is what, I mean, so the musical instrument works like this. So I was working with light responsive proteins at the time, and I was like, well, light responds, like these proteins respond to light instantaneously. And their response can be measured spectroscopically. And spectroscopically is basically just absorbance, right? How much something absorbs a certain wavelength of light, which can be measured. So I thought, well, what if I integrated this protein with a built spectrometer and integrated it with a synthesizer type instrument? So it would be like playing a piano, but instead of hitting a string and the string vibrates, I'm hitting the protein and the protein vibrates quantum mechanically from the light, and that response is measured and then turned into sound instead of the string vibrating and that response turned into sound.
So the absorption peak is what ends up being, the absorption peak vibrates and that's how the sound is generated.
Yeah, so the protein absorbs a photon of blue light. It undergoes this weird quantum mechanical energy transition that changes its absorbance spectra over time. So this can be measured, like, it's not just, you know, from one point to another. So it's not like a 0-1 binary. It's this, you know, analog transition that can be measured. So it's just like an analog sound, just like anything else, you know, string, any sort of string. And then you just plug that in, you know, to have it some have it have some effect on a note. And then basically you have the protein vibration affecting the note instead of the string vibration.
But can you tune this curve? Just like if you have a string or a rubber band or whatever, the bounce after you push it depends on the material. Isn't it characteristic to that protein what the bounce is?
Yep, the timbre.
Totally. So I actually engineered different proteins that had different response characteristics so that you could get, you would have like different key, actual keys, right? So it's not the same protein in every different key press. There'd be different engineered proteins in the different key presses.
So, okay, but did you end up memorizing the sound of each protein so that you got what you wanted? And is it kind of like a distortion pedal where you don't know what to expect, but you just plug it in and see what comes out?
Kind of. I mean, right, so I always tell people like this, like, the first guy who invented a guitar, he didn't start out as, like, Jimi Hendrix, right? Like, it takes somebody years and years of practice just to be able to play a guitar that's been around for hundreds of years. So then inventing a musical instrument is a lot easier than learning to play it. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I get what you're saying. You're just kind of like, just you're kind of guessing. I'm sure if I spent years and years and years, like, studying this instrument, I'd be able to get it down really great. You know, just like I would be able to predict what happens when I strum the string of guitar, right? Like, if you hit a string on a guitar, you know what it sounds like? I don't. Somebody who plays a guitar, they totally do in their head.
Okay, so some of the bugs still need to work out in terms of, like, maybe speed of the protein going back to normal, different strings.
Yeah, the finesse of how it's the chromochord is designed, it maybe will be improved over time.
Yeah. And maybe glass, you can have like other proteins or quantum springs or something like nano springs.
Yeah, you know, so I've thought about a lot of different ways to improve it. Probably the biggest issue is that you have to purify the proteins every time you want to play the instrument. Which is a pain in the ass.
And they also degrade. The proteins die over time, right?
Yeah, so the proteins, you know, they get bad over time. So basically, like, once you use the proteins, right, then they're just gone. So you got, like, one performance per purification. And I've kind of given up on the chromochord because of that, because it's like people would be like, oh, yeah, can you just, like, come and play it? And I'm like, man, it takes me, like, 3 days to just purify the proteins. Like,
it's obviously repeatable enough, so you did two performances.
I did a couple. I was actually at MoMA, New York MoMA, last December? Something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Did a couple performances at the University of Chicago in Chicago. Another performance at another place in Chicago, in Germany. Was invited to have it in a museum in Germany, but I was just like, look, you know, like, it's going to die after, like, a day. Like, I don't know what you want me to do.
What were you about to say too, Matt? You said so.
I don't remember, yeah. If I can remember.
The other is that part of these performances and your idea, you said you're introverted, but also your upbringing tunes your outlook or source material for your ideas, right? Like North Carolina, Chicago, now Cali. I'm assuming that you're in the NASA lab in NorCal?
Yeah. It's a Mountain View. It's like Silicon Valley.
Right. So those three locations have been kind of source material for your ideas on top of internet stuff like Torvalds, Linux Torvalds, right?
Yeah. Well, I think for me, ideas, the biggest thing is, number one, to take time to think. I have this reminder set on my Google Calendar that says, take 5 minutes to think of something new today, every day. And it's the other, it's sometimes being in a different environment or being exposed to a lot of new information. So being around people who have access to knowledge and are willing to share that with you and providing that knowledge for other people, right? That's why it's good to like read papers if you're studying science or something like that and be willing to share that knowledge with other people. I think those two things, just spending time thinking and having new knowledge, are basically what gives me ideas.
I mean, I hope we're stimulating you, but also part of the thing is that you were at, it said you're at NASA, but you're also doing ODIN. You're doing both simultaneously, right?
Yes.
But ODIN is Kickstarter and NASA is grant funded.
Yeah, crowdfunding versus grant funding.
And NASA is more friendly to that than private industry, right? With doing crowdfunding or Kickstarters.
No. Like the crowdfunding is completely unrelated from NASA. They won't let you do any crowdfunding NASA.
Yeah, they won't, yeah.
But will they let you do two things at the same time, where you're doing NASA stuff and a different subject crowdfunding?
Well, maybe.
They don't have control over that, right?
Okay.
Yeah. No, I mean, I do my NASA job and then I do my other job. And
I mean, you were giving us knowledge about how to make biohacking more affordable and distributed and open source. And you're on that effort. Is there any input you're looking for? Like, you've given us some info. What info can we pass back? What about Austin or biohacking? Or, I mean, I'll say some of my background. I mean, I was doing electronics and operating systems and chip design before I got into biology because I did PCR in high school. So all the stuff you're saying about expensive pipettes and all that, I think the photolithography is more disruptive because it was cheaper to get access to than pipettes and distilleries and all that. Like, chemistry and biology have a different birth route than electrical engineering and chip design, you know? You see what I'm saying?
Well, nowadays, for sure, totally, right? But, like, all the stuff that you see in biology now today, right, came from some dude, some rich white dude in the 1800s, right? Some guy fashioned his own mirrors for microscopes. Some people invented their own pipette, right? So I understand what you're saying, but, yeah, what I want most from people is ideas. I'm a vampire for... ideas. Like I asked y'all earlier, like, if you could create anything, what would you create? Right? Because like I said, new knowledge, new information, new ideas is like Johnny Five. Y'all are probably too young to know that movie, Short Circuit. You ever seen it?
No, that's not too old for me. Yeah. Johnny Five. Number five.
Short Circuit. He's like, I need input. New input. You know, it's kind of the same thing. Like, to me, knowledge is the most powerful thing. We used to say it in the 90s, if knowledge is outlawed, only outlaws will have knowledge, right? So by spreading the knowledge, keeping the knowledge going, giving everybody access.
I mean, NASA has a pretty deep thing with biology, but it's related to space. Distribution in biology, distributed systems, like Richard Stallman, Les Torvalds pushed it. There's a transhumanism thing, and Biohacking Con is happening here. We'd be happy to keep seeding you with all the cons that are happening. There's more conventions happening here because it's cheaper. What we were saying earlier about all the co-working spaces in Bay Area, they are expensive, but we have more of them here because they're cheaper. But I would say that as a analogy or corollary to the body hacking con and the chips and the labs is the movie Gattaca really broke ground, and Ethan Hawke was here last week or this past week, and it's this whole idea of like designer babies and just pocket labs, like where you could just take care. What we were saying earlier about the whole delivery and DNA samples, in that movie they fixed it. Any person dating anybody can grab a piece of hair, go to your local photo drive-through or drugstore, drop in the hair, and out comes the DNA like 5 seconds. So that totally movie already dreamed ahead of us, you know.
Totally. No, it's gonna happen. I did this art project recently that was at ZKM, a museum in Karlsruhe, Germany. It's a really like cutting edge art museum. They do all like cutting edge art. So my project, what it did, it was it took a picture of somebody. So you walked into the room, it took a picture of you, and then it broke down your features using computer vision. So like your face, your skin color, your hair color, your eye color, and then it tried to predict your genotype from your phenotype. So there are certain genes that are associated with certain probabilities to certain characteristics you have. It tried to predict your ancestry based on machine learning of other people who identified with the same ancestry. So you could probably get even crazier in the future where you're not even going to need DNA, right? Once we start associating these traits more and more, just be able to send a picture of somebody to a company and they'll be like, this person has a stupid gene.
No, I'm with you. That's why I'm going to give you search terms to find me, but I prefer to stay out of frame because Google probably archives our images and you're already public because you're in LinkedIn and all that. But if you Google search Mike Liu, Yale 2002, you'll see a robot I built 15 years ago. And also, if you go to the Yale site, there's a lot more biologists at Yale than there are electrical engineers. We were kind of, there aren't a lot, all the Silicon Valley people get sucked to Berkeley and Stanford. So those of us who were at Yale, there's less of us. But also, my friend who went to Berkeley and Harvard runs imicrobes.com, which is in Emeryville near you guys. And he's hacking bacteria to work on the greenhouse gas problem. So he's getting a lot of VC funding thrown at him because of that, because it's a big buzzword, you know, greenhouse. So if you want data back on that, but I also think that if you want to hack into what other PhD people are doing that's cool, that might be a good way. Or if you want a regular discussion of scientific papers, that might be fun, because it's hard to just take a stack of 100 papers and just digest it all. It's sometimes fun to kind of treat it like a movie, like riff off it with other, or a piece of music, riff off it with other people, you know?
No, totally. That's why I'm, you know, that's why I'm talking, chatting with y'all, because I think it's important that people communicate with each other, talk, chat, hang out, right? So hopefully next time we can all get some drinks going and hang out and just have a chat about a paper or something like that. I would enjoy doing that for sure.
And do you get to travel with either NASA or ODIN? Do you want to come to Austin at some point? Or do you want to see...
Yeah, like I said, I'll probably be there in March for South by Southwest in the least.
You are? Okay.
Yeah. So
Mike recently walked in.
Yeah, it was Mike. Oh, you were asking, talking to Drew or Josiah?
Yeah, Josiah, earlier in the call we talked about the South by.
Okay, so that's happening. Yeah. But so there's some upcoming face-to-face, that's what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. So all the little lead-ins here, we can do groundwork to prep for your visit. And also, this is a kind of, Mac has known you before, but this is sort of intro to some of us other biohack guys, so I'm really getting to know all your predilections, but because you have bio and music, you're coming to South by for the music. Is that right?
No, I usually give talks and stuff.
Mm-hmm. On technology, not art.
Well, it's the intersection of technology.
Both, yeah.
Both. Okay, and you've done that before.
Last year, I did a talk on it was on some of my NASA work. And it just briefly touched on some other, like, more art cultural aspects. I'm waitlisted this year to give a talk, a longer talk. We'll see if it goes through. I'll probably come down anyway, which is just more on, like, genetic engineering. It was actually titled, I titled it, In 2053, Everything Will Be Genetically Engineered.
If you have the data, if you have the content prepped, and you get waitlisted, we can still host an independent forum for you.
Oh, that'd be fun. That might be totally cool.
Yeah.
Because it's all about content, honestly. If you have the content, we can try to pipe audience to you.
Oh, that would probably be totally cool. We should totally, yeah.
Because it's very Austin to be very Indian. Like, even the indie stuff is not indie enough.
We're meta-Indian.
No, we could totally do that. So I'll let you guys know. I should find out sometime in December. Even so, even if I do talk, maybe we should still do something.
Yeah, definitely.
I have a lot of biohacker friends who usually come to South By.
Okay.
So it might be cool to have a gathering at your place also to just bring, you know, public support for it and stuff like that. Because I know a lot of people would be interested in...
I mean, if you're into the fashion thing, my brother has a store in SF in the dog patch. But if you're into the supplier thing earlier you said about, like, keeping things cheap, another way to do it is to go the computer route. Even though chips and bio are different, the algorithm for chips is, or electronic devices, go to consumer electronics show or shows like it, visit all the vendors, figure out where the wiggle room is, or help them solve problems live at the show. It would be interesting to go to some type of bio lab supplier fair. You see what I'm saying? I'm sure they have them near where all the grant money is. So that's either MIT or Berkeley, right? Either one gets a lot of grant money, and we should try to infiltrate one of these things as a normal guest, but interact with them normally, and that should reduce pricing. You see what I'm saying? Or at least build relationships that if they can't offer it to everybody, at least you get a private route. You see what I'm saying?
A little bit, but you know, when I worked in labs and stuff like that, a lot of places are willing to give you better prices, but it's still like nowhere near what's reasonable for a human being who's trying to do stuff at home, right? It's like instead of $400 for a pipette, we'll sell it to you for $300, $100 off. And you're like, all right, but for like a normal person, that's like still really awful. For a lab, you're like, yeah, $100 less, that's awesome. But, well, right, you want to pay for $50.
We can even break the problem into two sides. This is kind of, I feel sad about this, but what I was saying earlier about if you had a dream cloud lab, right, like the Gattaca concept I said earlier, the problem in America is even if you mandatory sent it through all public schools, everybody had their own government-funded bio lab in their house, the percentage of people using... Like, let's say, just a simple example, you send an iBook to everybody, MacBook. Most people just use it for simple stuff like watch movies. Not everyone's hacking code on there. But if you send it to different countries, you get different responses. Like, for example, in Japan, where they work on pluripotent stem cells, wow, I think their penetration should be higher. So even if you solve the what we said earlier, the human and the machine part, the users aren't always there. So what we could do is split the problem into two. One is... keep working the angle we said to make things cheaper, right? Like, you know, pizzas a long time ago, it cost a lot of money to make and deliver. Or mainframes were very expensive, and now they're the size of an iPhone, and like $100. But also solve the human side, which is, let's do a Kickstarter. This is the inverse Kickstarter, which is, if someone could find 100 people or find a way to all 100 people who said, I have samples ready to test, I just don't have a lab, and you match them with labs that will give them extra bandwidth to do this, will just be the transport mechanism. You see what I'm saying? Like if you had a list for me of 100 people who just needed stuff done, I would go to UT tomorrow and knock on as many doors, because the getting people to give you extra bandwidth is an easier problem than actually coming up with the ideas, which is part of why I think you enjoy, like we do, being idea vampires. You know what I'm saying? But that would prove both sides.
That's a great idea. Yeah. It's also just more like what can I accomplish, right? Like that's a great idea for people to do. Right now is an amazing time, because I always like to relate it to, you know, the 90s. I grew up in like the computer hacker culture, and the 90s was like you could do anything and you could become notorious, right? You could do anything and anything would take hold. The dot-com bubble happened where people were just making companies that were the biggest bullshit and making millions of dollars. Maybe that's not for another 5 or 10 years. But, like, you people who are biohacking, you're that first incarnation, that first generation of biohackers who are going to do the things that's going to set the groundwork for everybody else after you.
Well, that's part of our motivation with some behind the scenes is some of us that were former, or some still are, you heard that earlier, Bitcoin people. But Bitcoin is going to get crowded real soon. So biology, it's, you know, the next thing after bio could be biophysics, and then quantum mechanics, string theory, whatever. So as you get deeper and deeper, like you have a PhD, the deeper you go, the less contact you might have with undergrads. Like you might, PhDs might have only contact with other grad students or other postdocs or whatever. So one idea is to take the cheaper lab or fertile idea project, both dual pronged, and send it back towards us. Therefore, you can take a city that's more populous like Austin and UT and do things that you can't do in Silicon Valley because the price per head is very high up there. The cost per brain power, brain cycle up there is very expensive. But yeah, if you could just say, I think we could create a local Kickstarter version of, like, let's go to UT and look for people who want to make something cheaper from a, you know, lab point of view, or people who want to seed ideas. Both seem to be, if you can get 10 to 100 undergrads to work on it, that would be more effective than whatever extra brain cycles you could squeeze out. Part of the awesomeness is, and maybe the why this is the first connection we would make, is Austin to Silicon Valley, because we're kind of opposites of each other in terms of our resources, you know what I'm saying?
No, totally. I mean, I can't. To be honest with you, I'm probably not going to live here for forever, maybe the next year or two, but it's just not affordable to run a business here.
Well, once you transition, you're going to know who your backup there is, right? You keep finding someone who's a richer and richer scientist in Bay Area your backup, right?
I'll move down to Austin.
Computer guys, we always think in algorithms.
I feel like the goal is to distribute those research needs to more and more heads around the Earth. And so it's not just one city or one city, but it's a global...
Yeah.
What I'm saying is, I agree with that, but it's a cycle. The fun part is in the beginning when it's fresh and fertile, virgin territory.
Kind of.
What's going to happen is, as you succeed, it's going to be less and less fun, but that's a good problem. That means the work is getting done, but you're just going to have to find new virgin territory to restart the process. But
there's always more virgin territory.
Exactly. There's always harder problems.
To a certain extent, but... You have to understand that the way academia and things like that work is super sad. It's like, let's focus on things that everybody focuses on, because if we don't focus on what everybody else focuses on, then our grants will get funded, our papers won't get published. But, like, there are still so many proteins in the human genome and bacterial genomes, we have no idea what they do.
Yeah, digestion is still very mysterious too.
Proteins of unknown function, they're called. Mm-hmm. Right? You go look
in the dirt. Yeah, there's proteins that have no corresponding gene sequence, that are just floating around, that are made by the body.
Proteins of unknown function, right? And we're talking, we've had the human genome now, was sequenced in the early 2000s for over 10 years. We still have proteins of unknown function. And you know how many papers there are on, like, P53, which is, like, related to cancer.
Yeah.
There's probably hundreds of thousands. Such a crowded space. It's because people want to be famous. People want to get the grants. People want to get the papers published.
Mm-hmm. People want to be safe and sustain their lifestyle.
Totally. You know what? A biohacker doesn't have to worry about that. They can just say, fuck it. I'm going to do whatever I want because nobody can tell me what to do. And they can work on one of these proteins of unknown function. Look at it. Figure out what it does, boom, right?
If you succeed in making it super democratized and easy to do, what's going to happen, and this is good, is like the way space travel or quantum mechanics was a rare magical art, it will become like taught in school, high school textbooks or middle school. Like, where are current...
I mean, school is going to change drastically, especially if this... gets seriously out.
Oh, yeah. All I'm saying is that little kids will be doing what super advanced PhDs used to do.
Yeah, yeah.
You move into more harder problems. But what happens is what you're saying is mirrored in music, where if the music says, we want more Adele, we want more of this genre, we want more cancer, we want more AIDS, and you say, hey, I want to do a protein that has no function, no practical thing, I call that jazz music. You know, you're moving off into a, but it still needs to be done. But sometimes you make your name doing a really weird sound, and you become like, you know, Skrillex or one of these new.
The Skrillex.
Yeah.
I like that. New. That was a nice one. You were really
you have to hang out in the boonies to like have a new sound. But the industry
is telling
you, don't do it.
It was a good analogy.
Yeah. They want the 3 to 4 minute radio songs. But
yeah,
no, you
they
have
want
to
a
go
certain
out.
Format. So that's what I'm saying, is that like separating the art of it and the business of it sometimes is useful, at least if you look at what music does. And it's not bad if your Skrillex becomes tomorrow's Beethoven or Bach, which everybody knows. It's just that you have to be really, that's what I think open source and Linus Torvalds taught us, is that he's weird because he still gets grants from closed source companies. He still works for Microsoft and does stuff. But this is the problem you have in pharmacies and drug industry, is if you close source it too long so you don't see the next generation just because you're worried you can't monopolize the patent, then you know you can kill off a whole genre. So it's like this, oh, you have a new secret, but once you've moved on to the next territory, because it won't hurt you, you have new territory, and ideas and art problems should be infinite. The way to make sure it keeps going without you is to push it back into the younger and smaller, the more widespread people, you know? Like teach it in music school. So all I'm saying is that we're fluent with you in terms of open and closed. And if you've got some closed and you need a trusted person before you totally open, we're good with that. But we're also looking for things we actively don't want to keep closed. Because I would like certain projects to be worked on at the undergrad level, but I also would like to see certain things. I would like to see the new magic your PhD could create. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They're two different battlefronts.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Yeah.
So, back to the chromacord and the proteins, how they would, you know, get old.
You're getting back to that, Mac? Come on.
Yeah, no. I mean, I've been thinking about it, and
okay,
like,
what you got?
Is something you would want to go back to something like proteins that are found in sense organs? These are proteins that are constantly stimulated, and they're designed to sort of renew themselves, or like rhodopsin does this isomerization where it ends and then it comes back. Or the hairs in the ear, you know, they're.
No, that was the idea. I actually talked to some people about doing cells with the, you know, hair thing. It starts to get a lot more complicated when you start to get like obviously what you really want to do is move towards mammalian cell culture, things like that, you know, like humans. The idea that I wanted to kind of
what if you had a microphone that was actually a biological, like you had an eardrum growing in the microphone?
Yeah, no.
This is what you were thinking.
The idea was kind of like to be able to culture your own cells, so just like take a cheek swab of your cells.
Yeah.
Then transfect them with DNA that said expressed, you know, a rhodopsin or something like that. And then you set up a system that responded to actual sound. So it responded to the vibrations of the sound you played. So you could kind of like jam with yourself. You could like use your own cells, engineer them, play some music. It would respond vibrationally and then respond back with some music. So you could kind of like play some music. I thought that would be like totally weird and awesome at the same time.
So what about, like, I've been reading about organoids lately, and what is it? Zebrafish, lateral lines, they've got the same ear hairs as in mammals, essentially.
Oh, really?
Yes. And what if you just grew the lateral lines as organoids, and... Then I was thinking about CRISPR. What are the differences between using CRISPR on prokaryotes and on eukaryotes and yeast versus mammalian cells? How is the protocol different? Are there differences?
The main difference is just how you get the DNA into the cell. The great thing about CRISPR, why it's supposed to be the next big thing, is because the protein and everything like that it works the same in all, like, almost everything they've tested. So from bacteria to, you know, zebrafish to mammalian cells, you can use the same Cas9 protein, you know, the same types of, you know, guide RNAs and template DNAs and stuff like that, and it works. That's the crazy thing. The main difference is how you get that DNA into the cell and engineer the genome. But yeah, it all works pretty similarly.
So what are those differences? How is it different? Do you need to get it into the nuclear envelope or the nuclear membrane or just the cytoplasm or?
So the biggest problem is how the cells uptake it. So for mammalian cells, there are a couple different ways that people try to get foreign DNA or foreign particles into the cells.
Yeah, you can cover little nano balls of like tungsten or gold and shoot it in the cell.
Yeah, a lot of people will use viruses. Or they'll also use
RNA transcriptase, right? Sometimes they'll use a enzyme.
Yeah, there's a lot of different. There's a lot of different ways that you can engineer mammalian cells. Bacterial cells are one of the easiest. You'd think it's because they're least complicated cell walls, but they're gram-negative bacteria actually have complicated. You know, they have a inner membrane and outer membrane. I don't know.
One way to codify this, I'm just thinking of a parallel algorithm. I'm going through the same issue right now. In your LinkedIn, it talks about you do C and Perl, but trying to teach elementary or middle school or high school kids, they're all different levels, how to code so they can make video games. It's hard because teaching an adult or a PhD is easier than people with less libraries in their head.
Why? That's not necessarily true.
Not always true.
A lot of times adults have way too many libraries
in
their head.
Correct.
They don't want to change them.
You're correct. I wouldn't say it's... But that's not my conclusion. My conclusion I was trying to make the point of is...
Yeah, go ahead.
It would be interesting that the questions you're enlightening us, if we can make diagrams and make like a... Some, you know, like a Khan Academy, that type of thing for the experiments, because that would also generate... The earlier example of how do you get 100 people to give you original ideas? They have to first know how all the equipment works and all the proteins and the transcriptase and all that. So it'd be interesting to see if maybe that's one way to dialogue with us or new populations of different groups of people. How do we communicate with them in a protocol that they can give us interesting new ideas back? You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I would totally dig making the tutorial videos with you and at the New Worlds Institute, which is a space thing that's set up here in Austin. There's this woman named Holly who's doing a lot in the educational space where she's getting a space colonization curriculum that's actually like going through at adoption at schools around here. And she had talked to me about designing a one month curriculum as like one class with like in like 4 hours a week or something it was, on how to use biohacking for some way that it's related to what we need to colonize space. Like if we needed to modify our genes to live on Mars better, what kinds of problems are those and how do we solve them? So, you know, maybe she would like to, I think she would like to work with you in the future too.
But I have labor related to high schoolers on that note, because it's well defined how to teach, well, it's getting better to find coding and video games. Like there's this class that's getting funded by Microsoft and IBM that this local at-risk high school called Connolly High School with David Conover, that's searchable by Google.
Right, we should get at-risk kids to become biohackers.
No, but they impressed me because they got grants. This is what I'm saying. It's the same process you go through with NASA or whatever. They get grants by what they do is they show that they can use Minecraft and they can use Doodle or Sketch or whatever tools are out there. And then they actually crossed over with new keywords by making a game about insulin. They made like a Doom-like game where you're like model what insulin does in the body. It was really cool. So what I'm thinking is that if what you're experiencing is what some of us high in the knowledge food chain go through is lack of mental bandwidth, I found that by partnering, and you can repeat this in San Francisco, whatever, but it's sometimes easier. Some of the high schools here sometimes are so hungry for new knowledge and technique that's an example where if you felt, it's not just you, if you could even save work, because I'm trying to help you manage a load, if on your end you can find other cool researchers around you that all they need is humans to receive the knowledge and convert it into a video game or an animation or something, that might be another way to propagate the knowledge more efficiently than just sitting in some of our few brains. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, totally.
So I just want you to know that's another available avenue, is to follow the coding and video game route to try to teach the animation of biophysical interactions. But let me pause, because I was seating you with Mac, but how about you, Sean or Sarah? Was there anything that you wanted to go deeper on?
Yes, incoming, going. I've been enjoying listening. Where's Drew over here?
Drew wants to know what you're drawing, Sarah.
Oh. I drew a little Josiah alone at NASA.
Send it to me.
Sure, perhaps. Just some test tubes and fun things. Little fun notes that are highlighted here. Yeah. Grind on, little hackers. yeah. What else is Drew saying?
And it can go in both directions, Max. Like, if it's adults who are worse, it's good because kids have more time. But if adults are like, I don't want to be a school teacher anymore, I want to biohack, that's good too.
Yeah. So if we have at-risk kids, this brings me back to actually something I did want to ask you. If we have people with like unscrupulous morals, like doing genetic manipulation, like dun dun dun. So what's gonna happen if all sorts of people can just like genetically modify stuff? Like, answer the ethical question that's looming.
Yeah, do you have any kill switch designs?
No, I mean, you can make those. What I always tell people is like, You want to know how easy it is to engineer a bacteria to kill somebody? Pretty easy. But you know what you got to do? You got to force them to drink this big thing of bacteria. Maybe it'll take, maybe it won't. They're never going to be able to spread it unless they go and they throw up on somebody else or poop on somebody else, right? Modern sanitation basically prevents so much disease spread. So if you're going to force them to drink it, and then you're going to make sure they don't take any antibiotics or anything like that, don't go to hospital. It's so much easier to get a gun in just about every state and shoot them. Like,
right.
It's like water, you know, like the river, our American rivers. You get them to drink that.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's
you see that, like, it seems like if you have a malicious invader that's either created intentionally or accidentally.
Secret project by the U.S. government.
Okay, well, I'm not, I don't know about if it's by the U.S. government. Say just somebody in their basement with, like, limited resources, that it would be much easier to create the resources to manage that once, you know, if it was an issue. Either through antibiotics or through something large scale, yeah. Like.
So something that we see with cypherpunks and hacking.
It's a sci-fi novel, yeah.
In general, is that, like, if you have a huge population of people that don't understand anything about security, then they are vulnerable. If they start learning about hacking and cryptography, and if they start becoming more able, then they'll be able to protect themselves and be a part of that, like, that right. Ancient battle that is all of the pathogens and just all of the genetic noise that's floating around.
Yeah. Yes, sanitation is already a battle won, a little bit. The bacteria is out there.
To make a disease that wipes out any sort of population greater than one is so difficult. so difficult, right? Who are you going to test it? Number one, who are you going to test it on? Are you going to kidnap some people and be like, all right, now first you take this bacteria, and now I'm going to see how transmissible it is to you, you know? And then you're going to engineer it to try to make it better? Like, who are your test subjects?
You're going to scientifically measure the communicability and stuff.
Like, what are you just going to do? Just, like, throw it on somebody and hope they transmit it to some? Like, that's not going to work. Like,
it's easier to view knowledge. A law of knowledge is like a martial art. Like, you could be lazy and wait for a samurai to come take you out, but it's actually good to learn karate and all these things to...
Yeah.
Because you could use karate to do bad things too, like rob people's lunch money or whatever. But also, earlier we had been putting all this pent-up demand for more knowledge, but part of that reason is because also taking advantage of what runway you have in Silicon Valley is that Silicon Valley is only maybe trounced by one other place, Los Alamos, New Mexico, for the density of PhDs per capita. So
actually, the NSA building is
pretty high too.
Yeah.
So we know in these
probably the International Space Station.
Oh, that's pretty high too. Yeah. So anywhere we know there's high concentration, it's counterpiped from high concentration. It's
probably like 50%.
And also, like a lot of Texans feel their education system is breaking down. So it's not just you. It's like any other brains around you, any other PhDs around you who are like-minded and want to spread. It's all about this high density to low density knowledge. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's just convincing people to spread knowledge or do things is difficult.
People have to find their own motivation.
But the
motivation is intrinsic, so it's hard for that motivation to come from the extrinsic.
Yeah, it's hard to be like, hey, you should go help out these disadvantaged kids. Right.
No, we can use the bait that is Austin. Like, we already talked earlier about South by Southwest. Maybe we can make that a Kickstarter too. Bring brains from Bay Area to South by Southwest movement, you know?
Something I've been thinking about with the design of the co-op. We're thinking about doing the biohacker thing as a co-op out here because everybody likes co-ops in Austin. And if, like, housing co-ops get grant money for doing low-cost housing, low-price housing for people, maybe we could get some grants for doing education for those at-risk kids that we've been talking about.
That'd be awesome.
That way we could have a more vibrant community.
But what we're also saying is that we're willing to be as innovative on the motivation scheme. You know, motivation scheme is quite important with humans. What are they motivated by? So if you notice a scarcity of something in the Bay Area that we have an abundance of here in Texas or Austin or any other place we want to position as a haven, that's another way we can barter knowledge for people you might have contact with. I mean, you did say you're introvert, so maybe that circle is more limited than we think.
That's a cheap space. If you're running a biohacker space, find some place that doesn't cost anything, so then your member dues are not that expensive, so then everybody wants to come, right? Who wants to pay $100 a month to, you know.
But that's not enough. Sometimes the reason I say this is because my family's also related to Newegg, and they were offered the same thing by the Chinese government. So the Chinese government will charge no lease, zero, if you move it there because they have all these ghost cities. Mm-hmm. So it'd be interesting to see if what you're saying that we can map it there, but there are other issues. I mean, obviously, like intellectual property patents and defense or whatever. But it's possible. I actually think it's possible with all the couch surfing people we know here in Austin that do it around the world to figure out where the low costs are, and it's not attractive until you get a whole community there, just like a space station. Space station's cool, but if you have to be there on your own to Mars the whole way, that kind of sucks. So
that's it. Do a couch surfing where everybody who comes, they have to do like, hey, I need you to set up my PCR reactions or something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, like biohack couch surfer barter.
Amazing.
But you're exactly right. Like, so we'll continue to keep thinking about how to be more motivational. Because you're absolutely right. Like, science, you can be motivated, but sometimes it's just that little extra nudge for what's awesome to get someone motivated to do it, you know?
Yeah, just providing them the resources, right? If you give them access to resources, give them some training and some chance, maybe a couple ideas that they can grow off of.
And we know your runway at Bayer is like 1 to 2 years, that ballpark, right? So we have you dense in that area for a while, but we can also help out if you need research as you begin to transition on other places, because we're not only, at least me, I'm not just making Austin awesome, but looking for all awesome spaces to do knowledge work or to build communities, you know?
Yeah, totally. Totally.
So we're here for you if this is an intro call on that.
No, I appreciate it. I'm sure we'll stay. Like, feel free to email me anytime. I have a kind of a little bit of backlog of emails right now because of the Indiegogo and stuff. But, if you send me a short email with a question, I have my cell phone with me 24/7. I usually send you back a reply pretty quick. So, ask Mac.
I feel like we can save, that's what we do here in Austin too, we save work up emails by having these mega communication nodes. Like, if you know you want to hear from another human, let us know, or want to query the whole group, we can try to set up interactions like via teleconference, but we only do it when you have idle. I don't think you'll have idle for a little while as you get closer to South By, I think.
Yeah. I mean, I could always hear an hour or two like this, but...
Yeah, okay. Do you have any other questions for us?
What would you create?
Yeah, so I was thinking about that. And I love the idea of like indicators, biological indicators of, say, like, I heard something, there was a project to make your urine turn like different colors,
yeah,
depending on
e-chroma.
What's happening e-chromy in your body. That is so cool, and I don't know if I can buy that. I would want to try to make my own version of that. And I'm not sure exactly what I would test for. You know, I need to kind of like see what's possible, what's cool. But I would love to know, like, if my I don't know, if I had some pH imbalance or blood sugar, or if I had something dissolving in my urine, like excess calcium or protein or something. Like, that would be
totally cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is totally cool.
Mine's a brother that I love, the family of Lab on a Chip. They were trying to work on like these little blood samples they could put on a business card, right, like cardboard paper, and they send it in. That's very primitive, but if you can do like assays with biochips, nanotechnology, where you can, like a whole mainframe is now to an iPhone. If you can do a whole room of PCR down to a little business card size, because you're doing things in nano, either nano or micro, meter, that type of nanotech. That would be super cool because, example, this morning on CBS this morning, they're talking about how, I guess it's inspired by the Charlie Sheen story, that there are people now who have AIDS but are taking this drug that if they take the drug every day, I think it's $1,000 a month, they won't transmit AIDS. So then they stop using condoms, and then what happens is HIV infection goes down, but other STDs boost because they have false confidence. They start doing unprotected, so other STDs are propagating. So it would be – in Gattaca, they did it for childbirth, like instant DNA, but it would be interesting if you could have Lab on a Chip and do all types of disease screening instantaneously on demand, like in real time. So yeah, that when you meet people or these communities are doing such, you give them more tools. Does that mean that all humanity's evils will go away? No, there's still irresponsible things that will happen. But I think part of it is because people have false confidence. An example where even they fixed the HIV problem, a new problem propped up, a new whack-a-mole. So it would be interesting if we could create more in real time, on the fly, lab on a chip, really. That's my headache.
No, that's pretty cool, right? Because then you could go, and when you're going to have sex with somebody that maybe you don't really know, you're just like, hey, urinate on this real quick before we have sex, just so we can tell.
I mean, I don't know if they'll treat it like a prenup, but it's definitely not just STDs. I mean, people have been talking about this for designer babies. Like, maybe people don't want to procreate if they'll produce recessive cancers. And so you can even remove the sex from it and just be about procreation and be like, while without designer babies, you could do like, let's first figure out if we have to use in vitro or all those things we just talked about. They require instantaneous knowledge. You can't be like, just like you said earlier, you can't be like, in 2 years from now, we'll give you a result of your fertility test. That's terrible. No one's going to be able to deal with that. So it would be the Human Genome Project showed us that computers can actually speed things up. So that plus new sensors plus new nanotech, I really think that's really important. And I hope that doesn't become like the next, you know, Viagra, where it takes a long time for the generic to come out. Like, I really think if that's kept in open source and we keep seeing that, I don't mind disrupting intellectual property. I wouldn't mind seeing all the lab on a chip. We keep sending copies of it to like all the other security hackers, like DEF CON or Lias Torvalds. Just keep sending them stuff. I think they're pretty smart people if you have the right videos. That's the key. The videos will help translate from one knowledge locus to another knowledge locus. So, but the key is, like I said, on demand, real time. The only way you get that is new sensors or new speed. You know.
Yeah, it's crazy where health is at right now. You know, just to bring up something before we finish up, like that. People don't have access to tests. They don't have access to treatments. They don't have access to all these things. And it's because everybody thinks you're stupid, right? You're going to misuse the drugs. You're going to misuse the tests. And it's just like, right, come on. You have to think of people better than that. Obviously, there's stupid people out there.
But we know where that comes from. Like, we know where it comes from, and I think that might lead to the cure. On one hand, in Austin, there's a term, the keyword is alternative medicine or natural healing, where they don't try to keep you in the system to feast off your illness as a prophet. But it comes from back in the day when, like, the priests, they would keep the Bible, like, in Latin, so the human population can't read it. Only they can read it.
Yeah.
So Gutenberg was, like, super disruptive and be like, okay, let's put it in English. Or let's put it in other languages so people can read it. And that totally messed the whole Catholic Church up. But that's the exact same thing happening with super high-paid doctors and pharmacy. They try to encrypt the knowledge in weird, arcane languages because there's an advantage. Now, I do believe you should allow to have some secrecy before you release because you're an artist. I know Prince is kind of a really anal about people using his samples, but I do respect that he gets to choose who gets to sample his stuff. But that's different from, like, okay, all people cannot use violins. You know, all people cannot use piano now. That's very disruptive. So that's what I was saying earlier with education. It's not just to be nice. I think it could be disruptive of how to turn all the Latin stuff into a nomenclature. Even if people are not literate, you can make photos. People more and more like those pictograms. So if there's any disruptive education, that's another way to keep the priesthood from, like, you see what I'm saying, like, lording it over. Yeah. That's the key to fix that one.
It's a stupidity cycle. You don't have access, so you're stupid. And then they're like, look, they're stupid, so don't give them access. But, you know.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
It takes
exactly.
little people to break the dam of knowledge.
Well, I mean, you could have the problem where you release the Bible in English and everyone speaks English and they still don't read it. Okay, that's a different problem. But you don't know that until you decrypt the knowledge. And also, if you're worried that people will use the Bible to, like, do holy war, you don't know that until you have, like, warriors on the other end who will stand up against that. You never know until you release it. So there's some things you can't release, like, I don't know, like if you had a mythical button that could kill people instantaneously through thought control, maybe that's a little too early. But until you have an antidote.
you're getting some crazy ideas out there, Mike.
I mean, you're talking about the attitude the idea was. You're talking about a mythical button, but like a human body is a general operational thing. It can do so many things. It can do that. It can do a million other things.
Oh, so don't stop it because it's in its subroutines.
Yeah, I mean, all people have that ability. Everybody can instantly kill somebody. Oh, it's possible, but there's so many things you can do. You can do almost anything.
My solution to the anything is bad is as long as you create the super thunderbolt, I'm just going to make up a word, super thunderbolt.
Okay.
As long as you can create the anti-super thunderbolt, then you can release it. Because both are coming in the system. If you can't balance out the power and you release it, you could be we could be in for the next smallpox, you know what I'm saying?
Like you were describing gene drives, and I was like, oh no, what if a gene drive gets loose and bad stuff? And they're like, it's okay, we'll just create another gene drive that comes and chases it down.
Yeah. And I'm okay if you think that, but my solution to that is to set people up next to you who are watching you, not to spy on you, but as soon as you get that power, they would have the antidote power right next to you. That's the key. I mean, the closest I can come to it is either in physics, when you have a electron, you got to have a positron. It's this sense and anti-sense balance that allows really bad things to live next to really good things. If you don't have those two things, you could actually, you're making a very good point that just because things have free will and can do very bad things doesn't mean they shouldn't exist. That's a good point. But my only solution to that is to time it with its antithesis. It's very Greek mythology. Like,
right. Yeah, yeah,
and
yeah.
Is that your responsibility or is that the responsibility of the gods, right?
Well, like,
does that emergently happen? How do you divide a
But I'm just giving you guys a keyword. I'm giving Josiah a keyword if you ever want to refer to us on this topic. I call it the sense and anti-sense problem because in Greek mythology, or even if you're a writer, like you're a Shakespeare or whatever, you generally want to create your heroes and anti-heroes simultaneously because the universe gets unbalanced if you just like let the Joker run wild, you know? Like all people will be dead before the next chapter, so you actually have to create the two people at the same time.
Nobody dies in comic books. What are you talking about?
Yeah, they come back to life too. But you see, in biology, you have this happen, right? As soon as someone creates some antigen, you know, or some mutation, you're immediately worried about like a kill switch.
Is there a meaning behind the choice of the Odin name? I always thought it was named after the god Odin, and then somebody told me it was the Open Discovery Institute, and I was like, oh, okay.
Well, the Open Discovery Institute was just chosen because of the Odin, but Odin's like the All-Father, right? So it's basically like given the ability to people to create anything.
Yeah.
So the Open Discovery Institute is just kind of like the generic name that actually fit the acronym.
Yeah, the backronym. So,
yeah. It's okay if Odin. You are this, but it's a tragedy. The Greek story of Prometheus is a tragedy.
Was Odin a tragedy? Is it like Prometheus?
Odin is Thor's father.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So the anti-Thor is actually Loki, the Norse Joker, you know? So I don't know how to solve it, but you can also have the opposite. If you're worried that I'm only arguing positivity, if you have too many positive people, you can also flood a world with too many positive people who become a virus too. So for me, it's about maintaining some version of higher status quo. I'm not saying keep bad stuff, but the balance grows higher. I don't know. That's just my way to give a language to it. I don't know. But I just want to make sure you knew that we worry about that. We can entertain you with that type of stuff if you get bored.
Totally. Thanks, Mike.
Okay.
My biggest problem right now is that my drink is empty and I need to find the positive.
That sounds terrible.
Buzz us when
you guys talking with me, though.
All right.
It was fun.
Yeah, thanks, Josiah. We'd love to try your kits, and also we're about to buy a bunch of stuff, so.
Yeah, just hit me up. We'll figure something out. Totally like to help you guys out.
Mm-hmm.
Appreciate your time so much.
Peace. Thank you for your work in the disruptive sector.
Great.
No problem. Talk to y'all guys soon.
Yeah.
Bye.